that will cold freeze. Had a big, event over. I'd like to know what is the status of Los Angeles Power with respect to this, and yet we have them in our legislation. Are they out of it? Is there interest that was going to be transferred, I believe, to SRP or others? Has that been done? Because this is a contract, and their names are in here, and it binds them. And so are we binding people that have opted out already, or entities that have opted out already? And although the speaker wants to talk about this to the end of time, you know, these are questions that we have, and they're legitimate questions. The second thing too, Mr. Speaker Pro Tem and members of the council, there is news report that Nevada Power Company is deciding to opt out of this, running this power plant. We need to verify that. And again, what is the status? And so it might totally modify these legislations. The third question that it poses in my mind is, can SRP handle this load if everybody is dumping it off on them? See, and the same thing that happened with Four Corner Power Plant might happen. And that is, they might just say, use one of the clauses to say, we're out of here. And don't say you were not forewarned when you run for re-election. Because we're forewarning you. And if, you know, in 2 years, we may actually have none if they decide to opt out SRP because they can't handle the load. Those are events that are happening as of today. And I think it's very important that we discuss it. The other thing too, and this has been raised by Delegate Witherspoon many times, and that is the conflict that the U.S. assistance included in the amendment, the conflict that the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation has. When we were meeting in Phoenix, I asked a question to SRP representative, said, what is the possibility of Navajo Nation assuming the management interest of the U.S. BOR? Because they do that now. Why can't Navajo Nation apply to manage that interest that U.S. BOR has? And I think there's nothing that stops us from making that request. SRP did it. Why can't Navajo Nation? For those that would just rather to have this thing be approved, you are shortchanging the Navajo Nation. That's what you are doing. And so I think it's very important that we analyze these things so that, you know, when we add on amendments like this, that we try to address those questions. And with respect to the amendment also. Thank you, Mr. Speaker Pro Tem. That's on the president's negotiating team praises the study. You know, and it's real interesting on how people praise studies without analyzing it. And so this one, and it, but if, let's say for purposes of argument, that those numbers are correct and that it's over $1 billion. And that why is it that then not less than 1% attaches, not more than 1% goes to Navajo economy? It all leaves the Navajo Nation. And that's because the current operation is not abiding by Navajo Nation law on Business Opportunity Act. These are some of the things we could have talked to the owners about, that we are very concerned about this, and even use the studies, whether they're credible or not, because they're using it, and say that, look, you are proclaiming that there are billions of dollars of impacts, and how much of that has remained on Navajo Nation. And then we can prove, essentially by driving out there, that there's none, or less than 1%. And so then by that, we could show the owner that there's partly adherence to Navajo Nation law on business opportunity. This is Navajo Nation resources being used to develop economic opportunity. And it seems to be only benefiting Southern Arizona. And that is wrong. You know, and it's real interesting when you looked at the map, you see all these power plants around the Navajo Nation. You see all these pollution around the Navajo Nation. But you go to Phoenix and they have water, clear sky, and they have lawns, and they have swimming pools. And that is all being transported from Northern Arizona to Southern Arizona to benefit them. And if you support this kind of effort, you would vote for this legislation as is. Because you're causing the migration of economic opportunities from Northern Arizona to Southern Arizona without really analyzing it. And I say shame on us for allowing that to happen. We should protect Navajo people, business opportunity, economic opportunity. Let our people also participate in the American dream. Don't let American dream be isolated to Southern Arizona. That's what we're doing. And that's what happened in the 1960s. Like, shame on the United States. They made the wrong deal for Navajo people at that time, and we're trying to drag that along without seriously reanalyzing the whole thing. And also shame on the owners for allowing that to happen. Do they not have a heart for Navajo people? Yes, it benefits 400 miners, but we have thousands of Navajo people. And we need to look at those opportunities for those thousands. And by creating economic opportunities there, they will participate in it. They may not be miners, but they could be business owners. That has not developed on the western side, and that has not developed on the Four Corners side. And because we allow and we vote these kind of leases in, and that's why this whole tragedy continues to this day. Thank you, Speaker Pro Tem. Members of the council and Mr. President, thank you for joining us. When we were talking about this, President's negotiating team threw in the towel without even firing a shot on behalf of Navajo individuals. When they were told that this is a deal killer, they threw in the towel. You know, and so be it. We are claiming to be sovereign, pre-exist, the American U.S. government, and all state governments, and it's time we disregard. It is wrong of them. These are federal judges using a doctrine called doctrine of discovery and all of that and plenary power that were done in 1700s. We all know that Columbus did not discover America. And yet they hold on to that notion, and yet we allow it to happen without confronting that idea. See, the same thing is happening here. The negotiating team didn't even fire a shot. Maybe there's ways to do it. And then in the U.S. versus Montana, you know, if you agree this by contract and by consent, then it's allowable. I understand that the U.S. Supreme Court is anti-Indian at the moment. They have decided over 30 cases, and almost all of them have been against Indian tribes. Some of them, almost all of them questionable. At one time, there was a U.S. versus Martinez that said that we don't touch those kind of cases. And now, the U.S. Supreme Court and the federal courts are pretty much touching every case that comes out of Indian country. And then there's a treaty between us and the U.S. government, two treaties, that was ratified by the United States Senate a long time ago. And then if you look at the U.S. Constitution, the Commerce Clause, on how we're recognized as to the equivalent of foreign nations. And yet, U.S. justices and U.S. judges do not honor their oath to the U.S. Constitution when they are deciding these questions. And in my mind, my opinion, they are making the wrong decisions, all because they think they have a bigger gun and that they can yank Navajo Nation around. And we allow it. We allow it. In this case, nobody fired a shot for Navajo preference law. They were told it was a deal killer and they rolled over. That's why we're insisting upon going back to the table and fight for Navajo preference and so that we can have economic development there. This has to do with realizing the American dreams through economic opportunities for Navajo families. And it's not being allowed by the president's negotiating team, and we should not condone that. And we should be able to submit amendments like this. Yes, next month the justice or the DOJ will probably tell us, we can't do that. You know, they'll be telling us that. But I like for them to invite the U.S. judges that have been ruling against us. And I think we should demand a meeting with them. We should invite President Obama here to talk about these issues. That at the federal level, we should seek changes. And it's just wrong for us to roll over every time we're told this by a federal judge that has never seen an Indian. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, pro tem, and I urge the body.